Welcome, my curious souls, and thank you for joining us today. You are listening to What's That Haint, a podcast that takes the myths and legends of the paranormal, dissects it down, and provides you the real evidence and research associated with ideas of the paranormal to allow you not only to be able to identify these entities, but to better care for your own cosmic energy. I am Mountain Mama, and this podcast is ran by Mountain Mama Investigations, an Appalachian high strangeness and paranormal research team dedicated to the preservation of historical locations with a focus in Appalachia and aiding those in paranormal crisis. We are a nonprofit organization, meaning any support you provide through listening to this podcast or following us on social media allows us to fundraise for materials and services needed in private paranormal crisis cases. In addition, it allows us to go out to these historical locations as we work to bring interest to them, as we want them to thrive for future generations to enjoy. Our other main goal is to do our part to help break the barriers and stigma around the paranormal and experiencing it. A bit about myself. I am a spiritual practitioner and medium, working in the areas of Reiki, chakras, tarot, and parapsychology. My certifications are in each of those areas, and I use these in individual healing sessions and in paranormal investigations. I work in what is called the old ways, and am constantly looking to find a better way to life and working to become the best version of me. I also dabble in Akashic records and all things that may be considered woo-woo. Always feel free to reach out if you have a question, because all are welcome here. With this being said, I am not a medical practitioner. If you are undergoing any type of physical or emotional stress that needs medical attention, then we support you in doing so. We would never tell you not to. Some of you may be wondering what a haint is. Haint is a term that has been used in various parts of the world, but for myself, it was used largely in my hometown and area of Eastern Kentucky. Haint is a common word used in Appalachia to describe a spirit or ghost or anything related to the paranormal or supernatural, really. This is why it was normal in Appalachia to paint their porches haint blue, as many folks worked on ways to rid their homes of these entities. Today's episode is about a haint or a type of energy called a tulpa. This is a continuation in our discussion of thought forms and is a branch off of the servitor we discussed in the previous episode. So now is your time to sit back, relax, and expand that mind. Envision this. You have finally decided to make that dream come true. You know, writing that book you always had the idea for. It's taken you years to find the motivation and focus, but it's really happening this time. The characters that you have carefully crafted in your head over the years during those daydreams at work are now finally going to be created by putting pen to paper, and that artistic breath of life will drift into your creation. You walk into your study decorated in the golden light of the setting sun, dancing through your bay window. You sit down to your antique desk with your crisp and clean pieces of parchment perfectly sitting in front of you. And you bid a hello to your favorite lucky cat desk ornament and tap its bobbing head as a smile takes over your face. You pick up that expensive pen you were gifted years ago. You swear it must be magical with its gold and floral design. You settle in and begin creating that main character for what you know will be a bestseller. A moment of closing your eyes and a deep breath, and you focus in on this character all the way down to the tweed fibers of his suit. You have been writing away for hours, so deep in concentration, when you feel a bit of wind whip past your doorway and you look up. That's strange. Even more so since you live alone. Maybe it was the cat. Wait. You look in the nearby chair and see Mr. Whiskers looking back at you. You stare at the doorway, And then something catches your eye in the other room. A man, standing there, with his hat tipped to one side, smoking a cigar while looking out the window. He turns to look at you and your mouth drops open when you realize that every part of his being is the same character that you just created on that piece of paper right down to his tweed suit. He smiles, just like you envisioned in your own mind, and while in total shock, you ask yourself, what is that haint? Tulpa, an odd word yet fun to say. But what does it mean? What could it mean? You see, we wake up in the morning, and before we can even open our eyes, we envision our appointments, tasks, and everything we must do for the day, or what we think we must do for the day. We are sometimes anxious just by the half-awake state we experience when we first move into the beginning of our day. We live in a time and society where we are so overstimulated that at times we have stopped being human beings and shifted into being human doings. When this hamster wheel spins so fast that we are constantly living in fight or flight mode, we sometimes forget the pure magic that we are. Almost as if we have put that spiritual part of ourselves on a shelf and said, "You stay there until I have time." But we never seem to. What happens if we don't make space in our minds? How can it affect our spirits and souls? What can occur if we put immense concentration into our ideas knowingly or even unknowingly? Well, friends, that's exactly what we're going to talk about today. You see, Tulpa is not a new concept by any means. It's been around for a long time. And I'm surprised on how often we don't hear about these kinds of things in the paranormal or supernatural world. But today, we're going to do our part and change that. So a tulpa is a thought form, as we've been discussing in this season, meaning this is an entity or energy that is created by, guess who? You. Meaning it is a human-made entity. So first things first. Let's discuss where these came from. There have been a lot of developments around the tulpa, but we are going to start all the way back. Tulpas are associated with Tibetan Buddhism. The earliest mention of this entity was in 1929 by Alexandra David Neal. She actually referred to the tulpa as a phantom and said that they were related to Tulkas, but stated that they were formed by magic. In Tibetan Buddhism, Tulkas is a translation used to describe the three bodies of Buddha. The bodies being the cosmic truth body, the enjoyment body, and a body that enlightened beings manifest into the physical world to help suffering beings. Now, according to Neil, the difference between the tulpa and Tulkas is that the tulpas are created by magicians, while the Tulkas are an aspect of Buddhas. Basically, both entities having the same type of capabilities, but being used in different modalities. So going with the Buddhist version, the idea was that the tulpa was created in order to aid those who are suffering. This does align with the idea in Buddhism that the world is full of suffering, and basically we are to accept that. And our work is to ease the suffering of others. So by doing this, we ease our own suffering. Like a collective consciousness kind of thinking. So a Buddhist monk may have worked to create a tulpa for the sole purpose of aiding in a difficult situation. Now, I imagine this would have been done for the highest and most loving good of the individuals involved. Or at least I hope so. So our work today is to move more away from the Buddhist version of this idea and into the more metaphysical creation of this entity, along with why someone would choose to create one. let's begin with how a tulpa is created. The main ingredient in tulpa creation is intense concentration. Alexandra Neal, who worked to create a tulpa to go with her research, said that she did so by prescribed concentration of thought and other rites. Many explained that in making a tulpa, you are wanting to imagine with as much detail as possible the type of entity that you are wanting to create, much like an author putting immense thought into the characters they create, right down to the fibers of that tweed suit. Beyond its physical appearance, you also have to create its personality, beliefs, and even mannerisms. Once you have planned every single part of this tulpa out, that's where your mind comes into play. You would sit down and then use visualization. This is a common practice in certain forms of meditation and hypnosis. You calm the mind and then envision a scene, environment, or in this case, an entity. You take in every detail. Side note, these visualizations are really great, by the way, for those who may have trouble with or maybe starting out with meditation. It gives the mind a story to visualize while you are also practicing meditation, and I highly recommend it as a part of your meditation routine and suggest it for my clients who are struggling with the monkey mind that begin with every spiritual routine. This is the part of the ego and brain that throws every thought you could ever have in a lifetime in your brain while you're trying to focus yet rested. At least that's how my experience felt. Now, all of us who practice meditation have experienced this at some point. It is normal. Don't give up hope, but stay alert a bit longer so I can tell you more about this tulpa before you drift into meditation. Now that we have created every possible detail of our tulpa, we begin to use visualization to bring it into existence. You can sit down and then imagine in your mind's eye. We will use this term to describe picturing something in your mind, mind's eye. Then you go even deeper than just physical appearance. You imagine what the voice would sound like, the smell of the entity, even the sound of its walk and its movements. From here, you would want to talk with your tulpa. That could be a tongue twister. Talk with your tulpa. You can do this in your mind or out loud, and this is to build a relationship with it. Now comes the shift of bringing this entity into our plane of existence. You would then imagine it right in front of you, walking behind you, being near you. It is at this point you continue to interact with the tulpa that you will experience it more, hear it more, and have it interact with you more. Now, this is the part that makes the tulpa so much more different from the servitor. We discuss how the servitor has the practitioner's energy inside it to give it life and is part of the practitioner and does what it is told or guided to do by that creator. The tulpa is independent, meaning it can do as it chooses, think for itself, and is not under control of the creator in the same way as servitors can be. And it can actually grow in power over time. I noticed that so many versions of creating a tulpa stresses the importance of building a trusting relationship with your tulpa because of this. Nothing could go wrong here, right? And this is the moment of caution I will bring to these ideas. This is the general method of creating a tulpa. I am in no way encouraging you to do this. And as always, I will tell you to do your research and to be sure you're researching through credible authors if you decide to try this. This is your don't try this at home moment, basically. So our next question is, why would someone want to make this type of entity? We know the risk associated, but what would guide someone to still try this? You know, the main reason given for creating tulpas, our companionship. Actually, just having a friend truly is the answer I got each time I found a new article or forum. Some may say that not only do they create themselves a friend, but a friend who understands them better than anyone else. Not only is this a best friend, but one you can never lose. It is mentioned that they help to build self-confidence or that they can support during difficult times. One other reason I came across was the idea that it could strengthen the mind by allowing it to become strong enough to create an entity. When did tulpas first really get mentioned? Like, in a time that wasn't too far back as 1929. So the first contemporary paranormal writer to discuss the tulpa was John Keel. For some of you, that name is going to ring a bell, and for good reason, because he was the author of the Mothman Prophecies. We know that tulpas are made intentionally much like an imaginary friend, that it's its own independent person, but can someone make a tulpa unintentionally? John Keel described this in his book, The Mothman Prophecies, and a situation where it actually occurred. A haunting in New York's Greenwich Village encountered this type of entity. The home was that of Walter Gibson, who wrote the Shadow series of pulp novels. You see, Walter, while working on his book series, became so deep in thought and concentration that his fictional characters started appearing in the home to be experienced by those living there. Not your typical haunting, right? They hadn't had trouble before until this happened. John Keel wrote, "The Tibetans believe that advanced human minds can manipulate these invisible energies into visible forms called tulpas, or thought projections." Did Walter Gibson's intense concentration on his shadow novels inadvertently bring a tulpa into existence? Keel mentioned in his research that he often found reports of paranormal experiences that resembled ideas of popular fiction. He theorized that the phenomena was real, but misidentified as ghosts or extraterrestrials when they were really tulpas. What does this mean for us in the paranormal field? This means that through intense thought, deep daydreaming, and focused concentration, we may be able to create an entity that never existed. Imagine you are going through a time of intense emotion. As a person who has experienced deep depression, I can say that at times it can feel like an entity of its own. I have actually heard of those who have encountered their depression as an entity, with it taking actual shape and form. This would lead me to believing that this would be an additional example of a tulpa unknowingly being created. As always, if you are going through a difficult time, we are glad that you are here. We want you here. And I will provide a helpline contact number in the episode details if you need a friend or someone to talk to. Can we unknowingly experience someone's tulpa in a paranormal investigation or our own personal lives? Well, most research will say that tulpas are not dangerous to others, but mostly to the creator. But in my own personal theory, I can see where maybe others have encountered other people's tulpas. Are you familiar with the creepypasta stories? You know, the ones that have some creepy characters like Slenderman and the Rake? Now, we know this originated from a story, but there have been a lot of reports of seeing these in person. But we also know, just like the author Walter Gibson, that in order to make a good story or character, the author has to put in a lot of concentration. Could the result be the manifestation of these entities into our own dimension? With knowing that the tulpa can take on its own life, will, and power, who is to say one of those sightings aren't the result of someone's tulpa? This leads us to a few paths. First, if you decide to create a tulpa, take a moment to make a thought-out decision on how it can affect yourself or others if something were to go awry. Secondly, what is your mind saying? Are we putting too much concentration into thoughts that our ego feeds us daily? You know, the ones that tell us we aren't good enough or tries to push, those limiting beliefs on us? Do we allow our minds to wander in those thoughts, or do we work to bring ourselves into the present moment? As Deepak Chopra says, the past brings us depression, and the future brings us anxiety. So our best option is to be in the present moment. Third, creativity and passion are some important aspects for the human experience. It is what drives us and fulfills us and gives us purpose. But it's okay to rest and digest. We can create entities by allowing ourselves to be lost in our interest. If we know that our intense concentration can create entities, energy, or thought forms, then wouldn't we want to make those the most loving light beings that we can? Much like how we use our minds and focus and methods like manifesting or the law of attraction, we have to ask ourselves, if we look in our minds, what are we creating? Now, this goes to note that it is impossible to control your thoughts. Don't even try. They are like clouds that float by. But we can choose what thoughts we give attention to or let float on by. I am not saying not to create, my friends. It's that creativity in us that makes the world interesting and gives it that spark. So why talk about these thought forms? Because by naming every entity or haint we encounter as a ghost, we limit ourselves. When we limit ourselves in the paranormal world, we don't always know what specific entity we are dealing with. And by not knowing this, we won't know the specific way to care for it or ourselves. Which leads us to the word ghost, being a very broad term when there is so much more than ghosts out there. But for now, my friend, we must digest what we have learned here and leave those haints to another day. If you enjoy this kind of research, stories, spirituality, or the paranormal, then feel free to follow us on social media to know what kind of shenanigans we're up to. You can find us on YouTube by searching Mountain Mama Investigations. We are also on TikTok as Mountain Mama IMV, and you can also search us on Twitter and Instagram. If you would like to tell some stories or join in on more of our Appalachia-focused information, then join our Facebook group, Haints and Haulers. We work to do live updates on TikTok and Facebook during paranormal investigations, so you can be a part of the team too. Want to ask a question or need help? Then send us over an email at haintsandhaulers@gmail.com. Links and tag names are located in each podcast episode description. We appreciate your support on these platforms as we work to raise funds for our nonprofit to give us access to items and services needed during paranormal crisis and to allow us to explore historical locations and advocate for their preservation and share those with you. If you are interested in standing behind this cause, then we will provide a link with no pressure for you to donate. Did you enjoy our intro music? If so, I am proud to say that it is from an Eastern Kentucky native. If you want to hear some music that will hit you right in the soul, then check out Annalise and Ryan on their webpage. The Huffington Post states that their music is resounding from the hollers with a haunting beauty. Well said. I am proud not only to have this music grace this podcast, but to also call Annalise family. She and her husband have worked to keep the beauty of Appalachia up on our ears. Well, friends, until next time, remember, if you see a haint, give us a holler.